Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Dr. Sachin, and today here at CowNet, we are discussing about methods of gaining space. So, why gain space and what is the importance of space? My guru always said when he was considering orthodontics, there are four things to manage. One is appliance management, two is patient management, three is time management, and four is space management. Gaining space, finishing the case properly is what is necessary and what the orthodontist always see. So coming to the topic in perspective of need as such, you might have around three or four questions on space management and gaining of space. And this is a topic that overlaps with periodontics as well, but I just pertain to the orthodontic points. And before we get into the topic, when it's speaking about space and gaining space, there are two ways on how to gain space. One is extractions, and two is everything else other than extractions. So basically, when we're speaking about it, space or space management, why do we have to do it? It's because one, to shift the treatment to a non-extraction line of treatment, and as it's being so now, there is a lot of importance given to a non-extraction line of treatment than an extraction line because of patient compliance and also because of the treatment mechanics. The second one depends on space requirement. If you have more than 5 millimeters of space that is required, then you go for an extraction. If not, you can manage the rest. If the patient has a straight profile, you would rather go with a non-extraction line than an extraction line. And if you have a patient who is growing, you can use the growers and maintain the space. And you always know that you can intercept at mixed dentition and convert the case from an extraction to a non-extraction. And the use of leeway space, which is very important, is also why you have to maintain and gain space. Extraction of third molars and sometimes distalization of second molars is another way of gaining space. So the methods of gaining space would be these eight. The first one is basically a space maintenance, that is gaining of space, but I will still put it in so as to, you know, give you a broader perspective understanding of space. So the first one is the use of these spaces or the leeway space, also termed as the leeway space of Max. The second method is going to be your interproximal reduction, earlier called as just reduction, disking, or stripping. The third method on how you would do it is arch expansion. The fourth, as all of you know, and most patients would know, is extractions. The fifth is the derotation of posterior teeth. The sixth is the distalization, wherein you distalize the whole arch, including your molars in the anteriors. The seventh is molar uprighting, and eighth is proclination of your anterior teeth. So we'll discuss one by one. Coming to the first one, it's e-spaces or leeway space. So we at CrownEdge would want to have an interactive class. So all those who are live, if you are there, please come up with answers on the live YouTube chat. And I have a few questions also in it, along with a few explanations. So it would be nice if you would have an interactive class. So the first question of this session is, preservation of e-space can help in A, relieve crowding, B, reduce proclination, C, finish a case with non-extraction, or D, all of the above. I'm pretty sure all of you feel this is a very simple question. So we are just getting started and the questions will go on as and when it goes. So I'm pretty sure all of you will know the answers to this. So the answer to this question, as all of you know, is option D, that is all of the above. So what happens is, if you preserve e-space, you can relieve crowding, you can reduce proclination, and you can finish a case with non-extraction as well. So basically, coming to what e-space is, okay, we have another question, just give me a minute. Right. So the next question that we have is, which of the following statements are false in relation to transfalangeal or translingual arches? The first one is A, to maintain space, B, that the transfalangeal or lingual arches are active, C, they are welded or attached to the molars, or D, that they can operate molars. So this question might be a little tricky, but then the answer when it comes to transfalangeal or lingual arches are, they are all the same. They maintain space, they are attached to the molars, and they can operate molars as well. But if you have to regain space than to maintain space, then your option is B, they are active. So in this question, when it comes to space maintenance, the answer is B, that they are active. They are active is a false statement in this question. The next question is, amount of e-space in the upper arch is dash. So when you go to e-space, it is divided per quadrant and per arch. So in the upper arch, the amount of e-space is A, 2 millimeters, B, 2.3 millimeters, C, 3 millimeters, or D, 3.3 millimeters. I can see a lot of people online. If anybody can just pick an answer, it would be great. You can just leave your option on the chat, and it would be more interesting if you're interactive. So I'll just wait for one of you to maybe put an answer in. Amount of E space in the upper arch is A, 2 millimeters, B, 2.3 millimeters, C, 3 millimeters, or D, 3.3 millimeters. Okay, so the answer to this question is option B, that is 2.3 millimeters. And coming to how it is calculated, the next slide will tell you about it. E space is very different from leeway space. Keep in mind, E space is only the space difference that is seen between the second deciduous molar and the second permanent premolars. So in the upper arch, the second deciduous molar is greater than the permanent second premolar by around 2.3 millimeters. And you will gain, or there is a space of 2.3 millimeters that is in excessive in the upper arch per quadrant. And in the whole arch, you will have around 4.6 millimeters of space preserved. When it comes to the lower arch, the lower second deciduous molar is greater by the lower second permanent premolar by 2.5 millimeters, giving you a total space of 5 millimeters that is remnant in the mandibular arch. And this is how you can utilize the E space. Now coming to leeway space, the amount of leeway space in the upper arch is option A, 0.9 millimeters, option B, 1.9 millimeters, option C, 2.9 millimeters, or option D, 3.9 millimeters. So the question says about leeway space, and what leeway space basically is the distance or the difference between your deciduous canine to your deciduous second molar to your permanent canine to your permanent second premolar. And the answer to this question will be option A, 0.9 millimeters. And this is how it's calculated. So in the maxilla, the canine and the deciduous first molar are relatively smaller than the second deciduous molar. And the canine and the premolar and the permanent dentition are greater. And they will have a difference of 0.9 millimeters of excessive space in the maxilla per segment or per quadrant, and a total of 1.8 millimeters in the maxilla. And accordingly, in the mandible, it will be around 3.4 millimeters. So, you might have a few picture-based questions that might come into your need if it goes online. I hope it is already online. So in case it does go online, then these pictures are for you. The picture on the top is a translingual arch in the mandible, and the picture below is a transpalatal arch in the maxilla, which might have an anspertal attached to it, which engages in the palate and then maintains space. So both of them are made with a 0.036 inch stainless steel arch wire soldered to the first molar, and they are in contact with the cingulum of the mandibular incisors, and the Nance button is at the palate. Remember, they are not active, but they are passive when it comes to maintaining space. They can also upright the molars, and if they are active, they can increase the arch length to about 2 millimeters. And when they are in place, they can also relieve the incisor crowding by 5 millimeters because of the distal direction of a force that is driven towards the arches. So coming to the next step, the second step of gaining space is interproximal reduction. So coming to the question first, which of the following are space gaining procedures? A, proximal stripping, B, disking, C, IPR, or otherwise termed as interproximal reduction, and D, A and C. So there is five options here, the fifth one being all of the above. This is just so that you know that interproximal reduction also has a lot more names, and the correct option, the correct answer for this question is E, all of the above. The next question, when it comes to interproximal reduction, the questions are based consecutively in the same topic so as to, you know, help you better understand, and then we go with explanations later. So the second question is, the maximum amount of enamel reduction that can be done is option A, 25%, option B, 50%, option C, 75%, and option D, 33%. Okay, I can see you saying that my voice is echoing. Give me a minute. At the same time, is this better? Is my voice better now? So the answer to your question here is the maximum amount of enamel reduction that can be done is option C, 75%, and this was given by Peck and Peck. And your next question is IPR is indicated when? Four options are A, there is a need to gain lower anterior stability, B, there is a space requirement of greater than 4 mm, C, there are black triangles, and D, all of the above. The answer for this question is option D, all of the above, because if you do IPR, there is a need and there will be increase in anterior stability, and the space requirement, if it is lesser than 4 mm, it can be corrected through IPR. And if there are black triangles that are seen after you finish close your spaces and if the teeth alignment are not nice, you can eliminate black triangles using IPR. And hence the answer is option D, all of the above. Coming to your next question, analysis used for assessment of a case for IPR is or R. Option A is arch perimeter analysis. Option B is your Bolton's analysis or Bolton's tooth size ratio. Option C is your Peck and Peck analysis. And option D is all of the above. If somebody can type out the answer, it should be very nice. Okay, so the answer is correct. It is option D, all of the above. Just to give you a preview on how you do it and what the other methods are, I shall discuss in the future slides. So coming back to the discussion of the topic as such, when it comes to proximal stripping, it is also known as slenderization. It is also known as disking. It is also known as proximal slicing. It is also known as reapproximation. It can be called enameloplasty or odontoplasty. But the term that is now usually used and clinically used by orthodontists is IPR, or it is called as interproximal reduction. Please make a note of this and you might get a question on IPR with any of these names. So when it comes to the amount of IPR that can be done, you can reduce up to 50% of your tooth structure, both mesially and distally. And how much you can do per teeth is you can reduce around 0.25 millimeters of mesial and the distal in your anterior teeth and 0.3 millimeters mesial and distal of your posterior teeth. So per tooth, you can get a space of 0.5 millimeters in the anterior and 0.6 millimeters in the posterior teeth, which means to say that in the maxilla or in the mandible, you can gain around 9 millimeters of space in total. That means to say, if you have a case that is borderline for extraction and you do all your analysis, all your model analysis, all your cephalometric tracings, and then you see that there is a space requirement of around 9 millimeters, you can definitely tell the patient, given other conditions are right, like the profile and other stuff, you can go with a non-extraction line of treatment and then do your IPR and then close the spaces and give a nice smile to the patient. So when the indications of IPR are, is like I said before, the first thing is the patient's profile should be class 1 or it should be straight. And I've mentioned as 4 to 5 millimeters of crowding or proclination. That means to say around 4 mm of crowding and 5 mm of proclination or whatever that adds up to 9 millimeters can be dealt with IPR. Now, this is another information that all of you should know. I'm pretty sure you've heard of ANTU 6 keys of occlusion. So what has come in recently is Bolton's ratio or the Bolton's discrepancy, that is your tooth upper anteriors and lower anterior ratio of the Bolton's, is called the Andrew's 7th key, and this should be matched so as to gain good stability in your occlusion. And IPR is something that will help you achieve this. So Bolton's discrepancy ratio is an indication. If there's a mismatch, it is an indication of IPR. Like I said, like we discussed about black triangles, if there is an aesthetic contouring or recontouring because of black triangles, because of hypodontic to hyperdontism, because of any shape or size discrepancy of any tooth, you can do IPR, you can take some space, you can maintain space and give a nice aesthetic smile as well. The next thing is your peck and peck ratio. I'm pretty sure all of you know what peck and peck ratio is. It is the distance or the length of the tooth buccolingually and mesiodistally, and there's a ratio that falls in. And if anything is exceeding the ratio of peck and peck as per the charts, you can definitely go ahead with IPR and do it. We spoke about anterior stability, lower anterior stability. So in case you have some teeth that is very proclined or very malposed and you've aligned it nicely and you feel the Bolton's does not match, or you feel your intercanine distance is increased, then you can do your IPR and it will help you prevent relapse, and it will also reduce the chances of late mandibular crowding that might occur as and when age progresses or as and when your third molars erupt. So what are the armamentarium used? This again will be helpful for you in your picture based questions. So the first thing that you all, I'm pretty sure all of you know, is the first thing is the mechanical stripping, where you use a strip and then just rub it around between the teeth buccolingually. So the first picture here with the one you can see is of mechanical stripping. The second method is called as an air rotor stripping, and there's another method called air motor stripping. Air rotor stripping is where you use your water spray that comes through your air rotor, and then you can do it with your burrs or your strips. So when it comes to the burrs, we usually call it as a needle-shaped burr, and that is what we use to, you know, do your IPR. And you have your strips that work with air rotors, that work with micromotors as well, and that is what you do in your air rotor stripping. When it comes to air motor stripping, there is water spray that is coming in. That is, you use an air rotor to do your IPR, and you can do it with your strips or your disc. The picture on the bottom left is of the disc, and on the bottom right is of your strips, or it is called as an IPR set or an IPR kit. The problem with all of this, and the best method in all of this, is your air rotor stripping. But the problem with your IPR is, try to avoid as much as possible your air rotor stripping with your discs, because it might hurt your labial mucosa and it might cause discomfort to the patient. So what are the precautions? Complications that you might face. One, it has to be done judiciously and precisely, because if you reduce a lot more of an enamel, it will lead to your irritation of the pulp, and it can cause pulpal irritation, pulpal hyperplasia, and then you might end up doing a root canal for the patient as well. So what you need to do is take good care, reduce as less as possible within the limits, and then make sure you're not doing it mechanically or air rotorily. You do it air rotorily where there is, you know, a spray of water coming in. You need to make sure that the surfaces are smooth. So when you're doing your stripping, after you do your stripping, you can use a pumice and polish it, or you can use fine discs or fine strips that come, polishing strips. Do it and then give a smooth surface so as to prevent plaque accumulation, which might further lead to caries. And after all of this, what you need to do compulsorily is apply fluoride. So in case you get any questions on complications or precautions, make sure if there is fluoride, pick that option up. Coming to the next method of gaining space, it is called arch expansion. Coming to the first, what arch expansion is it is a procedure which is gaining space and which can be managed without extractions. And it is classified into three parts. One part, the first part is your dental expansion. The second part is your skeletal expansion. And the third part is your passive expansion. We shall discuss what dental, skeletal, or passive is in later slides. And there are also two methods of expansion based on your mechanics. One is slow maxillary expansion, or also called as SME, and the other one is rapid maxillary expansion, otherwise known as RME. Coming to the first question on arch expansion, the model analysis that you would use to decide on expansion is A, Pond's analysis, B, Linderhart's analysis, C, Ashley House analysis, or D, all of the above. Somebody is here still in the class. Can somebody please give an answer to this? the model analysis that you would use to choose, decide on extraction is either A, Ponds, B, Linda Hearts, C, Astley House, or D, all of the above. Somebody who can answer. Maybe this is too simple for you guys to answer, so I'll just go ahead. The answer is D, all of the above. And this is how you do your analysis as well. So what you do in Ponds or your Linderhardt's analysis is you calculate the distance between your premolars and you calculate arch length, and then there's a ratio that comes in. Calculate your sum of incisors, and then based on it, the formula is sum of the incisors into 100 divided by 85 for Linderhardt's, divided by 80 for Ponds, divided by 64 in the molar area for Linderhardt's, and divided by 64 again for Ponds analysis. So Ponds says that if you have a ratio or a measurement of 0.8 at the premolar region, after your calculation, you need not expand. Or if you have something at 0.64 millimeters or your percentage at the molar area, you need not expand. If anything is more than that, you would have to go with arch extension. The Linderhardt also seems the same method, and that is how you do it. But when it comes to Astley House analysis, I'm pretty sure all of you know, this is an analysis where you decide if you have to extract, expand, or treat the case with non-extraction. The formula is as such: the premolar basal arch width percentage is what you need to take, and it is calculated by the premolar basal arch width, which means to say it is the buccal cusp of either side of the premolar of the maxillary arch into 100 divided by the total tooth material of the maxillary arch. If your ratio is between 37 to 44%, you can go with the non-extraction method of treatment. If it is greater than 44%, you can go with a non-extraction. If it is somewhere between 37 to 44%, you can either go with an extraction line of method, or you can go with your fixed orthodontic therapy and reassess and then plan for extraction. And if it is less than 37%, you can go with an extraction line of treatment. So these are the analysis that you would know if you have to do your arch expansion or not. Coming to the next question, expansion is not indicated in. Again, this is a very simple question. The basic idea, intending it to be that you need to know the right answers than the wrong answers. So expansion is not indicated in option A, crossbites; option B, class 2 malocclusions with a constricted maxillary arch; option C, cleft lip and palate; and option D, scissor bite. Anybody who would want to give the answer to this one? Okay, the answer for this question is again option D, scissor bites, because we know in scissor bites that the labial surfaces of the maxillary teeth lie buccal to the buccal surfaces of the mandibular teeth. That means to say that they are very wide apart and you do not require expansion. But then when it comes to crossbites, you know how crossbites are. The buccal surfaces are blocked by your mandibular teeth, and hence you need to expand. If you have a class 2 malocclusion with a constricted maxillary arch, you still have to expand. And there is a phenomenon called as a foot and shoe, which we'll discuss later, that will come to it. And when it comes to cleft lip and palate, there is usually a maxillary constriction, and then you need to expand. So these are the cases where expansion is indicated, and that is when you do it. So coming back to indications, the first picture that you can see on the topmost area of the slide is your crossbite, where you can see that the buccal surfaces of the maxillary teeth lie lingual, or they are blocked out by the mandibular teeth. The second question is, when there is mild amounts of crowding, you can still do expansion where the space requirement is not more than 9 millimeters. It can be used in conjunction of functional and orthopedic appliances. The picture below is of a cleft lip and palate, and the picture to the right of it is what was used to treat the same case of cleft lip and palate. The picture is of a rapid maxillary expander with hooks that are given at the canine area, or usually at the molar area, to give your elastics so as to protrude the mandible forward as well. And you also use it with the class 2 with constricted arches, and that's how it goes. So coming to the next question, RNE causes maximum opening of the mid-palatal suture transversely in the following region. Mind the question says it is the transverse area, that amount of area that has expanded is what we are measuring, and the maximum amount of the mid-palatal suture is in the following area. Option A is the posterior part of the palate. Option B is the lateral part of the palate. Option C is anteriorly near the incisor area, and option D is equally in all areas. Now, I would want somebody to give the answer to this question, question 3.3. RME causes maximum opening of the mid-palatal sutures transversely in the following area. Option A, posterior part of the palate. Option B, lateral part of the palate. Option C, anteriorly near the incisal area. And option D, equally in all areas. Anybody who's in the class can give an answer. Okay, so coming to the part, the answer, it is option C. It is anteriorly near the incisor area that you can see the maximum transverse expansion. And this is how it happens. The RME acts in such a way that it is a fan-shaped expansion, and it causes spacing in the maxillary anterior teeth, whereas in the maxillary posterior teeth, they also move buccally, as in they expand transversely, but they also extrude downwards. In the mandible moves down and backwards. And like I said about the foot and shoe phenomenon, it basically refers to sometimes when your mandible is blocked out or you have a class 2 and you give an expansion appliance to your maxilla, the maxilla enlarges, and the canines of the mandible will usually be, you know, held onto by the maxillary canines, and the expansion of the same will get the mandible forward as well, improving the profile. This is something called as the foot and shoe principle, and this is something that you need to know. And this happens with any expansion appliances and particularly with the RME. And at the nasal cavity, if the patient has a deviated nasal septum or if there is a stenosis or stuff like that, your RME can also help decrease your air resistance by around 45 to 60%. So in case there's a question that comes up to say that there's a patient who's class 3 or patient with a constricted maxilla and a deviated septum, and what appliance would be best used for it, you can go with an RME because of the expansion and also because of the improvement of your air resistance that you can get. Coming to your next question, please pick the odd one out in these appliances. The odd appliance of the four would be, you'll have to choose. The options are A, Hyrax; option B, coffin spring; option C, quad helix; and option D, nitric palatal expander. If you guys were there in the beginning, I said there is RME and there is SME, that is rapid maxillary expanders and slow maxillary expanders. This is the cue for you to pick the right answer. Your options again is option A, Hyrax; option B, coffin spring; option C, quad helix; and option D, nitric palatal expander. Anybody who can give the answer to this? I think I'll wait for this. Somebody who can answer, that will be good. Okay, so that is the right answer, and the answer is option A, Hyrax, because Hyrax is a rapid maxillary expander, whereas the other three, that is the coffin spring, quad helix, or the nitric palatal expanders, are slow maxillary expanders. Coming to your next question, the appliances that do not help in the expansion of arches are option A, nitric palatal expander; option B, quad helix; option C, Nance palatal arch; or option D, the Demen system. The last appliance might be a little new. You might not know. I've just put it in an option so that you get a little additional information in case you get it. So the right answer is option C, Nance palatal arch, because it is a passive appliance and not an active appliance, but you can make the Nance palatal arch active as well and gain some amounts of expansion. But when it comes to the question, the option, the Right answer is option C, man's palatal arch. I'll come back to the Demmin system later on in the class, and you learn a little more about Demmin system. So coming back to a little more info, appliances that are used in expansion are basically removable and fixed. Removable expanders are the one that you can see in the first figure when it comes to your the four figures. The first figure on the top left is your removable expansion with a splint with an expansion screw. You can remove it and place it back, and the patient can do it. The problem with this is patient compliance. The patient might not wear it. When it comes to your fixed appliances, there is a tooth and tissue-borne appliances, or just a tooth-borne appliances. So the first one is the Dirschwiller appliance that you can see on the top right corner. It has a acrylic pad, and it is welded or bonded to the teeth from your premolars to your molars. And if there are deciduous tooth, you can use the deciduous tooth as support as well. The one you can see below are your tooth-borne appliances. The first one on the left side is an Isaacson, which uses a screw, mid-palatal screw. It's a nitrized screw that can be used. And the other one is an Hyrax. Both of them are bonded to your tooth, as in you place bands or you use a splint and do it. And that is how your tooth-borne appliances are. This is something that is important that all of you should know, is the activation protocol for any expansion appliances. They are given by two authors. The first author, or what is most commonly known, is called the TIMS protocol, given by TIMS. It is activated 90 degree twice if the patient is less than 15 years, and it is activated by 45 degrees four times a day if the patient is an adult, and this is done every day until the needed expansion is achieved. Coming to the protocol given by Zimring and Isaacson, they had a different approach, and they said your screw has to be turned two times a day for 4 to 5 days and one turn per day until the desired expansion is achieved if the patient is lesser than 15 years. That means to say, if the patient has growth left and it is 2 turns for 2 days and 1 turn for 5 to 7 days and 1 turn every alternative day for an adult patient until the desired expansion is achieved. We shall discuss a little more about how this expansion protocol is and when is the best time to expand on all of it in the future slides. So coming to the next question before we go is, what is the maximum amount of expansion that can be achieved in a day by RME? Your options are A, 0.1 to 0.2 millimeters, option B, 0.2 to 0.5 millimeters, option C, 0.1 to 0.2 centimeters, and option D, 0.2 to 0.5 centimeters. Anybody wants to answer? So a cue to this question is, basically your expansion will occur not more than a month or 2 months, and the amount of expansion that you will require will not be more than 3 or 4 millimeters. So ruling out option A, 0.1 to 0.2 millimeters is very less, so it is not the right answer. And I'm pretty sure option C and option D are in centimeters and we do not need it. So the right option, the right answer to pick is option B, 0.2 to 0.5 millimeters. So the space gained by expansion, be it an RME, is only for the cases of RME, is around 0.2 to 0.5 millimeters per day if you are expanding it with a rapid maxillary expander. And the total amount of expansion that you can achieve is around 10 millimeters. And it also depends on other factors such as your buccal cortical bone, the amount of bone, the density of bone, and how much of expansion you require. So if there's a question asking you how much is the maximum possible expansion, you can go ahead and tell them it is 10 millimeters of expansion that is possible using your appliance, rapid maxillary expanders. Coming to your next question, which of the following areas or bones resist maxillary expansion? Basic idea being that mid-palatal suture has to be opened when you are expanding, and what restricts your mid-palatal suture opening? Option A is sphenoid bone, option B is zygomatic bone, option C is all of the above, and option D is none of the above. Anybody who wants to answer, which of these area or bones resist maxillary expansion? Option A, sphenoid bone, option B, zygomatic bone, option C, all of them, or option D, none of them. So these bones are not related to the maxilla as such, and this might be a little hard, but the right answer would be option C, all of the above. The maxilla is connected to your sphenoid bone, The maxilla is connected to your zygomatic bone as well, and you have the two halves of maxilla as well. So these four bones play an important role on if expansion can happen or not. So if you are expanding, make sure that the mid-palatal suture is not fused, and make sure that there is not much resistance from the sphenoid or zygomatic acting. That means to say, if the bones are not thick enough, there will be a certain amount of expansion that will happen. Coming to your next question, the post-expansion relapse. So after you do an expansion, there is a holding phase or a retention phase, post which you go with your fixed appliances if required. So if you do not give the retention phase, or if there is a straight jump towards your fixed orthodontic treatment, there are chances of relapse. So the question is, the post-expansion relapse is greater in option A, Hyrax, option B, Coffin Spring, option C, Quad Helix, and option D, both B and C. Okay, so I can see a lot of you answering is option C, Quad Helix. I would have gone for it, but then the right answer is option A, Hyrax, because when you're doing a rapid maxillary expansion, the bone expands very fast, and there is lesser chances, lesser amount of time for remodeling to happen. So the right answer is option A, Hyrax, because a rapid maxillary expander, whereas option B and C, that is Coffin Spring and Quad Helix, are slow maxillary expanders, and it is easier. Don't worry if your answers are wrong. No problem, you will still learn it. But when it comes to relapse, just remember that when if it is a rapid maxillary expander, there is more chances of relapse. When it comes to a slow maxillary expanders, there are less chances of a relapse. The next topic part is your slow maxillary expansion. And slow maxillary expansion is more stable because there are less forces acting. And since it is slower in process, there is better bone remodeling as well. But the only disadvantage with slow maxillary expansion is it is mainly dentoalveolar and lesser skeletal. It is otherwise other way around when it comes to rapid maxillary expanders. The forces used in a slow maxillary expanders are usually 2 to 4 pounds, whereas in a rapid maxillary expansion, the force that can be used is up to 10 pounds. And expansion of a slow maxillary expansion device occurs over 2 to 5 months, whereas in your RME, it gets over between 2 or 3 months at the max, if the case is suitable for an expansion. So another picture-based question. The following appliance is an example of A, SME or slow maxillary expansion appliance, option B, rapid maxillary expansion appliance, option C, a space maintainer, or option D, none of the above. The right answer to this, the appliance is a quad helix. The quad helix is a slow maxillary expansion appliance. Okay, do not get confused. Rapid maxillary expanders are Hyrax. There is RME, Hyrax, Isaacson's, Dirschwiller method of expanders. All of them are rapid. When it comes to slow, most of them are usually attached to your teeth, especially your molars, or they are bonded or banded. And if you get any picture with a single tooth bonded or stuff like springs and coils and all of it, be sure it is a slow maxillary expansion appliance and then pick the slow maxillary expansion appliance. So the right answer for this question is option A, slow maxillary expansion appliance. Coming to the next question, this is one of the questions I recently came through. I'm not sure if it was in NEET or if it was in AIIMS. Palatal expansion device does not need a labial bow because option A, labial bow is not rigid enough. Option B, labial bow would limit the expansion effect. Option C, labial bow is not functional in the case. And option D, none of the above. So I do not expect an answer for this, a right answer for this. I'll just explain on how it goes. The labial bow, rigid or not rigid, does not matter when it comes to an expansion appliance. I can see somebody answering option B. Option B is a little controversial because if you can see in the picture that I've put, it is a split labial bow. When you're using a split labial bow, the amount of expansion is not hindered by the labial bow being present. Basic and a basic intention and the basic point of this question is being, will labial bow help in expansion or not? So it does not help in expansion, and the right answer is option C, labial bow is not functional in the case. this is something controversial. Either B or C can be present, but it, when it comes to expansion as a question, option C is the right answer. So these are for your picture-based questions in case you get it. These are examples of slow maxillary expanders. If it is a removable appliance as such with a jack screw, it is a slow maxillary expander. That is on your top top right picture. The one below is a coffin spring. You can see it in the shape of a coffin spring, and I'm pretty sure as UGs you have done your coffin spring wire bending experiment exercise and you would know it. The third picture is again a quad helix. All of these are slow maxillary expanders. There is something called a nitride palatal expander, where it is a nitride wire that is formed, superelastic nitride, which is compressed and then available in the market as such, and that can be used as a slow maxillary expander. There is expansion with arch wires that is possible. That is, when you go with higher arch wires, stiffer arch wires, I'm pretty sure you've heard of rectangular stainless steel. So those also provide a certain amount of expansion. I said we'll get back to the Demmin system. The next slide is about Demmin system and I'll discuss about it. And the last one, what you can see in the picture, is called auxiliary arches, or they're also known as jockey arches. This is a picture where there is a stainless steel wire that is placed in the bracket slots. And if you know that the molar tubes has something called a headgear tube, they will also have another tube called the accessory tube. So in this accessory tube, you can either place an Australian stainless steel wire, which is flexible, or you can place a nitride wire, which is expanded, and then place it above the arch wire and ligate it with the arch wire, and this will cause expansion as such. So slow maxillary expansion can also be done by an auxiliary arch or a jockey arch wire. So this is a little additional information called the Demmin system. Make sure you see the box, make sure you note the spelling. This causes expansion by the appliance itself. So they are passive self-ligation bracket system. They use copper nitride arch wires. The basic idea of this is the bracket is positioned in such a way, the bracket is manufactured in such a way that they receive copper nitride arch wires, and copper nitride arch wires are very flexible and they expand, and both in coordination will expand the arch. If you have a question on expansion, or if you have anything with the terms of arch development, and if you see Demmin in one of the options, choose Demmin blindly if there are no other expansion appliances that are available in the options. So, and one more thing is that arch development is almost the same and similar as your arch expansion as well. So do not get confused with both the terms coming in together. So a little more information about rapid maxillary expansion and the advances in it. Just know the names, just know the pictures. The one on your top right is something called as the MARPE, M-A-R-P-E, standing for Maxillary Mini Implant Anchoraged Rapid Palatal Expander. I'm so sorry, MARPE is Mini Implant Anchored Rapid Palatal Expander. If you can see in the picture, there are four holes that you can see in the palatal area. That is where your implants go, and it is a Hyrax screw that is used, and this can be used for adult patients when the growth is complete, and because of the implants, the opening of the suture is easier. The next advancement that has come is called the SARPE, that is Surgically Assisted Rapid Palatal Expansion. Repeating, it is called Surgically Assisted Rapid Palatal Expansion. What happens in this method is, you can use any of your expansion appliances, but all you need to do is get your OMFS, your oral surgeon, to come in, give a mid-palatal suture split, give a leaf out one fracture line, and start your expansion appliances. So when we go back to the question where I said about the sphenoid bone and the zygomatic bone, the leaf out one relieves your resistance from the sphenoid and the zygomatic, and the ossification of the mid-palatal suture is also relieved, and hence you can go with your expansion. So MARPE and SARPE are the advances that you can see in a rapid maxillary expansion. I think we'll take this one topic and we'll stop the class today after the completion of crystallization topic, and maybe we'll pick up the other methods of space scanning at a later date. So coming to your next topic on distalization, the following appliances cannot be used for molar distalization. Your options are option A, pendulum appliance, option B, Jones jig, option C, carrier class 2 collector, and option D, none of the above. Anybody who would want to try the answer to this? The appliances that cannot be used for molar distalization is option A, pendulum, option B, Jones jig, option C, carrier class 2 corrector, and option D, none of the above. Okay, so the right answer to this question is option D, none of the above. Option B is a disguising appliance. I'm pretty sure you would have heard in your UG, and it is there in Balaji as well. Option C is something new, which I will discuss about in the further slides. Let us skip to the next question. The next question is, orthodontic mini implants, or otherwise referred to as TATs, can be used for option A, distalization, option B, uprighting of molars, option C, retraction of extraction spaces, and option D, all of the above. Anybody would like to try to answer this? TATs can be used for option A, distalization, option B, uprighting of your molars, option C, retraction of, okay. The right answer is option B. TATs or mini implants are very versatile, and they can be used for any of the above treatment modalities: distalization, uprighting, or closure of extraction spaces. The next question is, pick the odd one out. The options being option A, Jones stick, option B, Pendex appliance, option C, pendulum appliance, and option D, sagittal appliance. Option D is the right answer. They are passive and they do not distalize your molars. And the other three are your distalization appliances. The question is formed only in such a way that you will know the names of the appliances that are there. So coming to your distalization appliances, sagittal appliances can give you a more anterior-posterior distalization that can occur. Jones stick, as you know, is a fixed appliance. A sagittal is a removable appliance, and hence it is the wrong answer in the previous question. Jones stick is fixed. Your pendulum appliance is also a fixed appliance. So if you have any picture-based questions, this is your sagittal appliance, the one below is your Jones stick, and the one below that is your pendulum appliance. Those who are fixed, the upper one is removable. The other appliances that are there and is the distal jet. As you can see in the distal jet, everything is palatal. So if the patient is very conscious on orthodontic treatment and does not want anything visible, and if just that distalization has to be achieved and later go with an orthodontic treatment, then you can use your distal jet. It will also act as a space maintainer after your space has been gained. And the next one is a transpalatal arch. If you can see, there's a modification in the transpalatal arch. The arches are supposed to be soldered or inserted into where the molar bands are, into a device called as a lingual sheath or a Gosgerian sheath. So in case you need to distalize unilaterally a single molar as such, then you can bend your transpalatal arch in such a way and engage it into the lingual sheath, and that will distalize your molar. So distalization can also occur with transpalatal arch is what you need to know. The next one is your carrier motion appliance and bone screws or tacks. I would like to show what your carrier motion appliance would be in the later stage. Before that, let's just take one more question. The average rate of distalization of a maxillary molar using a pendulum appliance is option A, 0.25 to 0.5 millimeters. Option B, 0.5 to 0.75 millimeters per month. Option C, 0.75 to 1 millimeter per month, and option D, greater than 1 millimeter per month. Okay, I'll show you the answers in the next slide. By the time, this is very speculative, the right answer is option C, 0.75 millimeter per month. Option B, let's just go with the next slide. I'll come back to this. When using a pendulum appliance or a Jones stick, there is option A, a distal movement of molar, option B, a distal movement of the molar and a distal movement of the incisors, option C, a distal movement of the molar with distal tipping of the molar, and option C, distal movement of the molar with mesial tipping of the molar. So basically, I think this is a tricky question for you to understand, but let's just go with options again. Option A is where there is only a distal movement of the molar. Option B is where the molar moves distally and also rotates or tilts distally. Option B is where the molar moves and the incisors also move distally. Option C is where the molar moves distally and the molar also rotates a little distally. And option D, where the molar moves distally and the molar rotates mesially. Anybody would want to give the right answer to this? The option is, the answer is option C. So when there is a distal movement of the molar, the amount of pressure that is there on the molar will also make it tip a little distally. So just know that when the tooth is going back, it will go back and it will go towards the chinchaiva, the distal side will go towards the chinchaiva, as in to say that there is a distal tipping. So coming back to the amount of expansion that was there, the molars will move 0.75 to 1 millimeter per month. I think I made a mistake. The right answer to this question is option C, 0.75 to 1 millimeter per month, and that is the amount of distalization that you can achieve per month. And when it comes to the previous question on the molar tipping, there is a 7.67 to 8.38% of the molar tipping distally as well. And this is an additional information that you might know, you need to know, that if the molars are distalized by 4 millimeters, there is a 1 millimeter of anchor loss. So whenever you are going with a distalization appliance, you use your premolars or your anterior segment as anchorage. So if the molar moves by 4 millimeters, then your anteriors or the premolars will also move distally by 1 millimeter, is what is the point of this appliance and the point of this. So you need to know if the molar moves 4 millimeters, there is a 1 millimeter of anchor loss. The next question is, the ideal time for distalization is option A, before the eruption of permanent second molars, option B, before the eruption of permanent third molars, option C, after the eruption of permanent third molars, or option D, after the eruption of permanent second molars. Anybody would want to give the answer? Option A, before eruption of permanent second molar. Option B, before eruption of permanent third molar. Option C, before eruption of permanent third molar. And option C after, and option D after permanent second molar. Okay, so the right answer is option A. It is before the eruption of permanent second molars. But keep in mind that distalization can be done even after the eruption of the permanent second molars. So the ideal time when it comes to the question, the answer is right. It is option A. It is before the eruption of the second permanent molar. So distalization timing, as I said, can be done even after the eruption of the second permanent molar. It can be carried out during the mixed dentition or the late mixed dentition or the early permanent dentition phase. And after your second molar is erupted, before your third molar is erupted, you can still do a distalization. Even if your third molar erupts, you can extract the third molar and then do your distalization. So we spoke about carrier motion appliance. This is how carrier appliance looks like. This might be helpful for your picture-based questions. This is a relatively new appliance. The one you can see on top is a carrier class 2 character where your maxillary dentition is distalized. You can see that the appliance is attached from your maxillary molar to your maxillary canine with an E-chain coming down to your mandibular canine. This works basically on the however your mandibular advancement appliances work, but there is a distal driving force of the maxilla. And the next picture is a carrier class 3 character where you can distalize your mandibular arch and mandibular molars. The appliance is attached to the lower mandibular arch from your mandibular molar to the canine, and an elastic is engaged to the upper arch. So the anchor unit for a carrier class 2 character is the mandible. The anchor unit for a carrier class 3 character is the maxilla, and that is how your distalization occurs. Coming to TADs on how they would distalize. There are a variety of TADs that can be used for distalization of molars or distalization of the entire arches. If you are distalizing the entire arch, it is called as en-masse distalization. And there are a variety of TADs that are available based on their nature. They may be your interradicular implants, or they might be something called as your bone screws. That is your IZCs and buccal shelf. I'm pretty sure all of you will know what TADs are or what interradicular implants are. They can be placed anywhere in the maxilla or the mandible in between your tooth and away from the roots of the tooth. But when it comes to bone screws, this might be something new. They are placed at the infrazygomatic crest or at the buccal shelf area of the mandible. If you can see in the picture below, whatever you can see on top, distal on the left picture, whatever you can see on the top of the maxilla, at the corner is your infrazygomatic crest bone screw, and what you can see below, after the mandibular molar, is your buccal shelf screw. The same way in the frontal view, what you can see very distally is your IZCs or infrazygomatic crest bone screws, and what you can see below is your buccal shelf bone screws. So TADs can be used for distalization. They can be used for a lot more purposes, which we'll discuss in the further topics. So I think this should be it for today on the methods of space gaining. We have discussed about leeway spaces, E-space. We have discussed about interproximal reductions. We have discussed about arch expansion. And now we have discussed about discretization. In the further classes, we'll take up extractions and the other methods that are remaining. If you have any questions, I can see a question asking about ACO appliance. I shall do that with a diagram, and it is a discretization appliance. It is hybrid appliance that is used. I shall do it in the next class before I start the topic. I will show you what ACO appliance is, and we can do it. And there's a question on which textbook is good for clinical orthodontics. Yes, Prophet is definitely a good book. You can do it. If there are any more questions, I think we have 4 minutes. I can take it up. Anybody from Clownage? All right, then that should be it for today. I hope the class was a little helpful to most of you, and I hope you are a little benefited with whatever I've shared, and hoping to see you in the next classes pretty soon. And to all the NEET aspirants and to all of them who want to be good clinicians, all the best. I would like to thank Clownage for the opportunity to, you know, let me present and take a topic of methods of gaining space, and looking forward for part 2. Thank you.